A very good evening to one and all present here. I am Maria Vini Palamazil, the co-founder of Argumenta Podcast. Mooting is a skill acquired by practice and research that attempts to better ourselves in the field of litigation by introducing us to the legalities of matters brought up and nuances of research and skills. The webinar title, Mastering the Art of Mooting, led by Advocate Aman Chowdhury, in association with Argumenta Podcast, Sources to Become an Effective and Useful Session Introducing Us to the Niche of Mooting. As we all know, knowledge is an eternal treasure and learning is an unending process. Before I introduce our speaker for the day, I would like to extend my sincere regards to each and every one of you for being here to be a part of this session. Advocate Aman Chowdhury is a practicing lawyer in Delhi High Court and district courts with specializations in criminal law, IPR and sports law. He is also a consultant for various sportspersons and an organization and is also the legal advisor for Human Rights Commission. This session is held in association with Argumenta Podcast. We are a platform to discuss, deliberate and debate on various contemporary social, legal and political issues. Our episodes are available on Instagram, YouTube, Spotify and more. Also, we could be tracked on our Instagram and LinkedIn pages headed Argumenta Podcast. Now, I would like to welcome Advocate Aman Chowdhury and ask you to be taking over at the session. Also, we request the participants to kindly mute your mics and switch your video cameras off throughout the session. Any questions and queries, kindly feel free to address them towards the end of the session. So please stay tuned. Also, we would like to request you to remain present in the session till the end and kindly fill up the feedback forms which will be popping up on the chat box during this session in order to receive your certificates. Thank you so much. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Maria. Thank you, Joel. And thank you, Argumentator Podcast, for having me here and giving me this opportunity to share my experience, my knowledge with each and every student present here. So, hi and welcome, everyone. And let's get on board and learn about the fundamentals of mooting and the physical, or I would say both the physical aspects of it and also the aspects that go into the theoretical part of it. So without much ado, without going into different topics, we shall just begin with it. And I'll just share a PPT if that's fine.
Yeah, surely.
Just a minute. I'll just... I hope it's visible. I'll just share the PPT.
Yeah. Yes, it is visible. The screen is visible.
Okay. Yeah. I guess the PPT is also visible now, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, welcome everyone. As I said previously also, that we'll be talking about mastering the art of mooting. So this is the topic that we'll be discussing today. We'll be understanding the fundamentals of mooting, the main core of mooting, what goes there. And I would be telling you about the tips and strategies that one should keep in mind for effective mooting and trial advocacy. Now, before starting, I would just highlight one important aspect that we have three moots that go in India. That is, first is moot court, second is bail application moot courts, and third is trial advocacy. So today I will be only focusing on mooting, whereas the other two aspects, that is trial advocacy and the bail application, they are somewhat have the similar aspects of understanding it. As we go towards the memorial part, or if we go towards the physical argument part, they both have all three of them actually have the same footing, just one or two differences here and there that I would be discussing later on in the part of the webinar. So this would be our plan of action that we'll be discussing. We'll be starting with these stages of moot court, how moot court is there, what all stages are there. Then as you can see, the second portion is decoding the moot problem. This is actually not many people discuss about it, and even when I was in my law school, no one taught me about decoding the moot proposition, and they start the moot court or moot court stages right from the point of researching. But this is actually the first stage when you need to learn how to read a moot proposition. Then second point is choosing an ideal team. We'll be discussing what an ideal team consists of, how you need to choose it. Then comes the most important part, that is the researching skills, how you need to research before going into drafting of memorial and compendium. Then comes the arguments part. You need to first prepare the arguments, and then I'll be talking about how you can physically present it. The last is tips and strategies, and last one would be the international moots. International moots is something which I would be touching if time permits. And if not, then a separate webinar or separate session can be taken on it, because international moots is something which goes in detail. So this would be the first thing, that is stages of moot court. And just to before beginning here, I would like this webinar to be more of an interactive session. So for the first 1 hour, I would try to finish everything. And we have another half an hour left where I would be taking up your questions and doubts. But if time permits, I want to discuss your viewpoints also on whatever you have learned. So I will be providing you with samples, but I will be also providing you with one moot problem towards the end of the session. And if time permits, and if you are able to do it, you can just first analyze what moot problem is, and you can work on it, what I will be teaching you in the further part of the webinar. So as you can see, this is just a basic stages of moot court. Ideally what happens is that you start from the research part of the moot court, of the stages of moot court. So this is something which only few people know, that there is also a moot problem which is to be discussed. So I would be talking about the moot problem first. Then we'll go on to the research part. Then comes your formulation of issues, which is in form of arguments, because when we are talking about arguments, arguments are in form of issues only. So formulation of issues, then we'll go further to formulation of arguments. Then it would be the memorial drafting. So if we talk about these four steps are actually your core of moot court, because this is something which you will be doing before going into the moot court. This is something which you will be doing when you step into the moot court room. So these part would be the one which you are doing actually the most part. You are researching about the arguments, then you are drafting it. So these would be the stages of moot court that we are concerned with. I hope this first part is clear with you all, and then we'll move on to the important part. This is the moot proposition. So I would be telling you how to actually read a moot proposition and how to actually analyze it. So this is something which, trust me, you will not find anywhere, because this is something what I have done in my law school, and this is what I have curated into certain pointers. So before going into the moot proposition, I would want you to just see a particular moot problem, that how moot proposition is seen. So I would first go on to the moot proposition which is there. I have a particular moot proposition for you guys. I found it. So I would be discussing that. See, this is the moot proposition that fortunately I was called to judge in. So this is how a moot proposition looks like. I would first take you through the moot proposition, and then we'll move to the PPT back. So you see, a moot proposition is like this. It talks about certain general facts of usually this is the starting of each and every moot proposition. It talks about the Republic of India, and the name is always changed because it's a fictional one. The most important part comes from actually third or fourth para, which talks about the facts. So this moot proposition talks about a 17 year old boy who went onto the internet, and he came across an advertisement where he applied to the advertisement and got a job. But as he was a 17 year old, and most of your aware of this particular fact that a person who is less than 18 year of old cannot get into a contract, he's not competent enough to get into a contract. So that is the main question of this problem. And it was his father who went on to fill the form. And so this is the moot
I guess there's a bit of a network issue. One second. Yeah, I think we missed you there, sir. Sometime.
Was it not audible in between?
Yeah, just for a minute. Listen.
Okay. So yes, I was saying that this is the moot proposition. It lays down certain facts that are in a particular important part. Then it talks further about certain dates and certain relevant facts that become relevant in the analysis of a case. And towards the end, sometimes you will be provided with issues or sometimes are not. And you can see as the last line says, they are free to frame any ancillary issues apart from the one stated above. So this is something which is there in particular of a moot proposition. So I think you guys saw what a moot proposition looks like. Now I will be telling you the most important part of understanding the moot problem, how to analyze it, and how to decode it. Now the word that I'm using is decoding. Why I'm saying that a moot problem needs to be decoded? The moot problem needs to be decoded because the moot proposition does not only contain about fictional facts. It contains about legal points. It contains a law. And it contains certain facts which are relevant or which may not be relevant. So you need to first demarcate or divide the moot proposition into these aspects. So this is why I'm telling you how to decode a moot proposition, how to understand it. And if you are not able to understand it, you will not be able to perform well in your research, or you will not be able to perform well in drafting a memorial. Okay, so coming back to the PPT that I was talking about. Yes, so this is the moot proposition. I'll be talking about analysis of the proposition. So just keep this in mind. If you're noting somewhere, note it that whenever you get a moot proposition, you have to read it at least 4 times. Now, why I'm saying 4 readings are important, because of the this is something that I have practiced and I've excelled also. So the first reading, whenever you get a proposition, just give a bare reading of it. As I've written, read it like a story, just plain reading without thinking about the law. For the first reading, when you are doing, just forget that you are a law student. Read it just like an English story. Why I'm saying this? Because you will get to know what the story is about. And law is nothing else but a way of putting up your story into legal terms. So when you put up a story into legal terms, you must have a story there. And one thing that moot proposition talks about or gives you is a well-written story at first, which is fictional, which includes certain facts, which includes drama, which includes emotion. So you need to just read it. And the second point is very important, which says make a mental timeline of the story, that is the facts. Don't write it anywhere. Don't write it on the proposition itself. Just make a mental note of it, that how it happens. Like, for example, the proposition that I showed you, it was a proposition which had facts like there was a contract made by the minor. He went onto the website, he clicked it, he saw the advertisement, he clicked it. Then his father signed and paid on his behalf, and then the issue started. So you see, there's a mental timeline of what came first, then what happened second. So this is something you need to see on the first reading itself. Now comes the important part, that is the second reading. When you are reading the proposition for the second time, take a pencil or a highlighter with you and highlight the facts that you think are important. Now, what I'm saying is that you think are important. You need to just put this point in understanding. You think are important. I'm saying what are not important. I'm not saying what are important. I'm saying what you think are important. As per your understanding of law, what you have learned till now, what you think that this particular fact A or this particular fact B is important or not, you just point out, you just highlight it, you just mark it under and just leave it there. What you have to do with it, I'll be telling you further. Then once you have highlighted or marked these facts in the mood preposition itself, write it separately on a sheet of paper along with the dates and details. So this will, what you are doing it here, that is a mental timeline. You're converting that mental timeline in a proper form in after the second reading. Okay. So this is something which you do after first and second reading. And trust me, once you are done with these two readings, you will know what the mood proposition is about and you will be able to actually learn it by heart. Now comes the little tricky part, or I would say a legal part, which is the reading and understanding of the proposition. Now comes your third reading. When you are doing a third reading of the mood preposition, it is also your plain reading. You don't have to go into the details, but very important thing is keep a pencil or a marker with you because you need to highlight certain things. Now, during the second reading, I said you have to mark the facts that you think are important. Now, for example, if this is a mood proposition itself, I find story is an important fact. So I'll just mark it here this way. If I think law is an important part, I will mark it this way. Now I'm just marking it. Now what I'll be doing it in the third part is I will be dividing it into three parts: facts, relevant facts, or facts in issue. In order to understand what relevant facts or what facts in issue are, we first need to understand what facts are. So these are the definition which is clearly given in the Indian Evidence Act. You are not required to learn them. You are not required to use them in a moot court or for that matter, trial advocacy or bail application. This is just for your understanding. So I will not go into the detail of explaining this. I will just explain it in the form of an example. So when we talk about facts, this is just simple thing. Anything, it says anything, state or things which is capable of being perceived by the senses. We all know we have five senses. Okay, so anything which can be perceived by all those five senses will be considered as a fact. Now, Evidence Act very nicely provides two types of facts for us. One is the physical fact, another one is the psychological fact. Physical fact is something which can be seen, heard, tasted or spoken. All these comes under the fact of physical fact. That is our four senses. Our fifth sense is the touching sense, which has a mental element to it. So anything which has a mental element to it, when we talk about intention or motive, that forms the psychological fact. So only two types of fact are to be considered. That is the physical fact or psychological fact. You are not to write these particular thing in the mood preposition, but for your understanding, you can mention that this particular thing is a psychological fact. This is a physical fact. However, it is not at all relevant. What is relevant are the relevant facts and facts in issue. Now, I would come to the relevant facts afterwards. First, I would talk about facts in issue. Now, facts in issue, if you understand it in a layman language, it is the mudda of a case. It means ke jo aapke case ka main mudda kya hai, aapka case kis cheez ke upar based hai, wo kya fact hai, which is an issue. So, the expression facts in issue means and include, this is just a legal definition. It says any fact ka matlab hai psychological, it can be psychological also, it can be physical also, which either by itself means apne aap mein or in connection with other facts. In connection yani ek fact dusre fact ke sath in connected hai. Agar koi bhi aisa fact jo apne aap mein ya kisi aur ke sath connect hoke kisi bhi right, liability or disability, this is something you need to understand. This is, you should not be very curious about it or very afraid about it, because law, when we talk about law is nothing else but talking just about someone's right, liability or disability. So any particular fact which talks about right, liability or disability will be a fact in issue. It is as simple as that. So what preposition that I showed you, it talks about a 17 year old being coming into a contract. So it is his disability. We talk about, it's a disability because a 17 year old person is disabled from entering into a contract. So this particular fact becomes facts and issue, और fact and issue ही actually वो चीज़ है जिसके पूरे इर्द गिर्द और पूरे आसपास हमारा केस बनता है. Now comes relevant facts. This is actually what we will be discussing. अब हमारे पास fact and issue आ गया. We know what the मुद्दा is और what the particular issue is. Now we, in order to prove that particular मुद्दा or particular fact, we need other things. These other things, what are these other things? These other things are actually evidences. अब evidences क्या होते हैं? Evidences ऐसे ही तो उठ के नहीं आते. Evidences are actually relevant facts. वैसा कोई भी fact which is said to be relevant to another. अब this another thing, this another is actually fact and issue, or this another is actually another fact. वैसा कोई भी fact which is relevant by connection, it would be considered as relevant facts. So you need to first in the mood preposition, whatever you have marked as important, you need to highlight कि कौन सा fact and issue है. और उसके ऊपर लिख दो कि this is fact and issue. उसके अलावा the other facts that you think are relevant. Now I am not saying which are important. I am saying which are relevant. You mark them as RF. Okay. So these would be your relevant facts. You need to put them. Now this particular habit of doing mood preposition and writing relevant fact, fact and issue, why is it important or why is it not important is what I have written here. You don't get confused. It says the main issue or cause of your case is the fact and issue that I've said, and all other facts which are relevant becomes the relevant facts. So you need to analyze this. However, one thing that is very important is you need to understand this particular fact that in moot courts, you don't depend or consider evidence at all. So whatever we did in the third reading should not be a part of your memorial, should not be a part of your arguments. So you would have one question in mind, then why are we wasting our time on this? We are not wasting our time. We are actually doing it just for this purpose. If you understand a proposition from the point of view of an evidence, then trust me, no one, not a single judge or the opposite counsel will ever be able to counter your proposition. You would not be able to counter your argument, and trust me, you would never feel yourself in a pit. And most important thing is this: if you do this habit, you're able to write relevant facts or facts in issue, this particular thing, then this would help you in a longer term when you go out from the law school and when you actually practice law. So this thing is very important. You need to keep that in mind. It is just for the better understanding of the proposition. And I again repeat it, you should not depend or consider evidence at all in moot courts. Now I'm only saying moot courts. When I say moot courts, the bail application moots also go hand in hand. However, the trial advocacy is little different. There you can actually consider evidence when you are cross-examining a person. So that is more of a procedural part that I will not be discussing because you will get confused. So understand, just understand this thing, that whatever evidence is given in the preposition also, whether it's the CCTV footage or whether it's the, for example, if there is a murder weapon there, you should not depend your arguments on that particular evidence. You can use them for corroborating. You can use them for particularly pointing one thing, but you should not base your full arguments on that. For example, I've seen certain people in my law school also, and when I was judging, they said that a particular murder weapon was found, which was a knife. Uske upar blood laga hua tha. This person came and said that just because there is a blood on the knife, then it is a murder weapon. Okay, that is given in the proposition. Then he went on to say that murder weapon was found near the vicinity of accused house. So that is why there is a possibility that accused may have thrown that particular murder weapon. Okay. Now, what I'm trying to say is you can use this thing, but just keep in mind that if that particular evidence was not there in the proposition, what would you have done? So that is the thing. The court in a moot court or the judge would not only rely on that murder weapon, because to be honest, what you're doing in a moot court is actually your articulation, your arguments, which you will be getting marks for. You will not be getting marks for what is already written in the proposition. So that is why I'm saying that if you have these kinds of things, use them freely, but don't depend or consider them. Okay. So with this, we're done with third reading. Now comes your final reading. When you are reading the final part, like when you're reading for the fourth time, try to analyze the law points. See, when we were discussing the first three readings, I was not talking about any law points with you. In the fourth reading, when you are completely aware of the facts, the fact and issue, then come to the law points. Clearly in the proposition, the sections would be mentioned or the act name would be mentioned. If that is there, clearly mark that thing. That this particular is, for example, 302, or this particular is section 13 of Hindu Marriage Act, just mention that. If it is not written, then you need to just brainstorm a little. This is not a researching point of thing, just brainstorm. And then your work is not done if you have only written it. You need to read the law that is applicable to the problem. So you need to read the law from the Bare Act. Don't go into the books. कोई यहाँ पे एग्जाम नहीं लिख रहे, साढ़े बारह नंबर का क्वेश्चन नहीं आ रहा है. सिर्फ और सिर्फ बेयर एक्ट से यू नीड टू रीड द लॉ. और व्हेन यू आर रीडिंग इट, इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट यू पिक आउट द एसेंशियल्स ऑफ इट. जो बेयर एक्ट में लिखे होते हैं ना एसेंशियल्स, वही एसेंशियल होते हैं. सो विद दिस वी आर डन विद द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ द मूड प्रोपोजिशन. नाउ कम्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट, दैट इज द डीकोडिंग. नाउ व्हाट आई एम सेइंग अबाउट डीकोडिंग, डीकोडिंग can only be done if you have completely understood the problem. So if you have not understood the problem after four readings, don't worry. Go on, read it for five times. Read it for six times or read it for 10 times. There's no issue at all. But minimum you need to read it for four times. Then these things are actually practical, which I'll be showing you once I'll be reading the mood preposition. It is read between the lines and read from one full stop to the next. Don't read the full proposition at one go. Write the important points in the problem itself, which I have been telling you in all the types of reading. Then this is a must thing that you need to do. Analyze which point is relevant to plaintiff and which is to respondent, because you need to prepare memorials and you need to prepare from both the sides. So the proposition is mixed with facts that is tilted towards plaintiff or respondent, and you need to find them out and write it. Okay, so now I'll be going to the mood proposition and be just briefly discussing the procedural parts that I just mentioned, how to decode it. It's very easy. There's not much of it because this is something which I want you to practice. Okay, so this is not something which I'll be teaching you throughout. This is something that you have to practice on your own. So I'll be sharing a particular this memorial, this problem with you also, and you need to decode it yourself. So I'll just give a brief decoding that you need, how you need to read. So see, as I said, two things: read between the lines and read from first full stop to the other. So the first line is, the Republic of Indiana became independent on August 15, 1947, full stop. Now understand this particular line. If you need to understand and decode, it does not say much. It just say that Republic of Indiana is actually India. That's it. Don't go into detail because it's not necessary. The next line, it is a region of rich flora and fauna. Its society is perfect, blend, blah, blah. This is just wastage. Don't go into it. What is important is, India is a progressive and secular nation and believes in peaceful cooperation with its neighbors. Not relevant for us. It is just put up to confuse us or to just use it. You should not use anything from para 1 at all. Now, this is something which is important because it says that the Constitution of Republic of Indiana has a legislative powers enumerated in 7th schedule of the Constitution, which means that the Constitution of Indiana is something which is similar to Constitution of India. That's it. Not relevant. We should not consider. This is very important. Mr. Sook, a 17-year-old boy. So first thing would be a 17-year-old boy. This becomes your relevant fact. Just write relevant fact there. Lives in city X, Indiana. Not important, full stop. He's extraordinarily versed in the field of computer science and is keen about learning and creating new things. Now this line becomes, you'll think that this line is not important at all, but this would become important from the point of respondent. Now, how it would be from the point of respondent, because it says that he's keen about learning and creating new things, and he's extraordinarily versed in the field of computer science. That means he is intelligent enough. Although he's a 17-year-old boy, but he has good knowledge, he has good brain, he is well versed with computer science, and he's keen about learning and creating new things. So respondent can take this particular line and mold it in the sense that it is the fault of Mr. Sukhoon, because he is so brainy, he's so knowledgeable that what he did, he was acting as a mature person. Although he was immature, this is something which is there given legally. So this becomes a relevant fact. But this particular line which I'm talking about, this becomes a relevant fact from the point of view of a respondent. Then on one fine day while surfing the internet, he stumbles across an advertisement for freelance app development by this particular company. This is also again your relevant fact for both plaintiff and respondent. Now, the advertisement specifically made a mention to the company's no contract with minors policy. This is a very important part which becomes a relevant fact from the point of view of again respondent, because the company is not at fault. Respondent would be saying what? That the company is not at fault and it is the fault of only Mr. Sukh. So as they said that they have clearly mentioned that there's a no contract with minus policy. So this is how you need to read between the lines. Now this particular part read with this particular thing, if we club both of them, we are actually making a strong case by the respondent. Just couple them with the two or three cases here and there, and you got yourself a one good issue. So this is something which is what reading between the lines means, or reading from one full stop to the other means. So I will be stopping here. This is how you need to decode a moot proposition. I will not be decoding it fully for you. You need to come up with your own decoding strategy. You can take the help what I'm telling you. Okay. So this was one thing which we have completed about the moot proposition. So your first stage is actually completed. You have understood about how to go for the moot proposition. Now comes I think this is a very funny part, but also a very important part when you come to choose an ideal moot court team. Okay. So I would just give a disclaimer. No moot court team is an ideal team. Every team is a good team, every team is a bad team. I have seen very great teams performing absolutely zero in moot courts. And I've seen teams that are utter zero, even winning national moot courts. Okay. So I've culminated 5 points that can help you actually choose a moot court team. The first thing is, can friendship be a criteria? This I have seen n number of times that people tend to form moot court teams in their own friend circle. This can be good, this can be bad. Now, how this can be good or how this can be bad is that if you have a friend circle, okay, and with your friend circle, you are comfortable, you have a good connection, then it's a great thing that you can go up and form a moot court team. Because in a moot court team, the most important thing is the balance between all three members. No one should be perfect, no one should be bad, there should be a balance. Okay. So if you know about the strengths and weaknesses of your friends and you can use them, then go and make a team with your friends. But at the same time, if you think that your friendship, your personal friendship would come in between of your professional moot court etiquettes or moot court culture, then don't form a team within your friends. This would be my personal advice, that you should never form a team with your friends in it. You can have one friend at least, but one person should be a complete stranger which you don't know. The second is, all team members must have a good working relationship. This is something which I said in the first thing itself. You should form a healthy relationship. It should not be that you are fighting amongst the team itself. So that is why sometimes a friend in your team could help to build a good working relationship. At the same time, your personal grudges can come in between also. And third is, form a team with higher level expertise. Now, this is very important. You get a moot proposition, right? Now, this thing is very wrong in our country that you get a moot proposition after you have submitted your team. However, it should be vice versa. First, you should be given a moot proposition and then you should constitute a team. So this particular part of forming a team with higher level expertise and subject matter expertise is actually which you should consider. For example, you take up three people, two speakers and a researcher. Never ever constitute a team with all three of members having expertise only in a particular law. For example, a criminal law. What would happen if the moot proposition comes as a mixture of criminal law and some other law? You would be just going haywire. So that is why all three members of the team must have knowledge of all the laws. However, each one of them should be expertise in their own field, should be expertise in a one particular law. Expertise, when I'm saying expertise, it is that they should know in and out of it. And lastly, divide work as per skill set. Not every other person is same as per their skills. So a particular person, for example, a researcher, if even though he's a researcher, but a speaker is well versed with the research, then he can also take up the researching part. And one thing that I would be telling towards the end also, as per the strategies and tricks, you can just keep that in mind. An ideal moot court team, according to me, is the team which works equally. What I'm saying is that there are three people. When you talk about researching, all three of them research equally, and it should not be only the researcher researching. All three of them should make the memorial equally. Even the researcher should be equally contributing in formulation of arguments. So this is something which an ideal team actually consists of. Otherwise, the points are that there is no predetermined criteria. No one can actually set what is an ideal moot court team. And individual skill set is actually, you need to use this individual skill set of each person to make the best team skill set. So just combine all the skill sets and make a skill set of your own team. Now comes your researching part. Now we come to the main core. This is something lengthy and we'll be discussing about it in the sense you need to first research, then you go on to drafting of memorial. So when you are researching, people tend to ask me that how do you research about a particular moot preposition? How you research about a, this is apart from moot also, when I'm researching in my legal fraternity, they say that how do you come up with the tools, how you go for that particular proposition and research about it. So I would be decoding it in the sense that the stages that I take up. So first you need to actually, before researching anything, you need to first understand the applicable laws, even if it is not mentioned on the proposition that I just said. While you were decoding, in the fourth reading, you mentioned all the applicable laws. Research about them. Research about them in and out, from the Bayer Act, from the net, from the book, for your understanding. This is, again, I'm writing in the brackets. This is only for better understanding and is not always meant to be written in the memory. I repeat, not always. Sometimes it's suitable. Sometimes it's healthy to write the applicable law and its detail in it. But it is not always to be meant to be written. Next is read the applicable law from the Bayer Act and understand it completely. This should be your first step of researching. Read from the Bayer Act and understand it. Then if you're able to understand it, refer to the books and commentaries for the basis of the law. Don't go into the details. Don't form an answer. Just on a blank sheet of paper, scribble down the important points of the law, just for your understanding. This is something that I've again written. Don't go into the complete analysis. Otherwise, you will go haywire. So this was in relation to the applicable law. Once you are done with applicable law, you will be able to find out the question of law itself. This is something which I cannot teach you, because once you are able to do this step one, once you are able to understand all the applicable law, then you will find out which is the question of law. Question is law is nothing else but what we discussed in fact in issue. Okay. So what we discussed in fact in issue will form the question of law. That particular fact in issue which was there, try to fit it in a question. Try to fit it in a law. That becomes it. So this is a very imperative and crucial part in cases of appeal or review. So question of law becomes a very important part in appeal and review, because this is the basis of your appellate memorial, your review memorials. So when I'm saying this particular thing, just understand, question of law is very important to be found out. Just found out, okay? Writing it is very important in the cases of appeal and review. So if you have a moot court wherein you are filing an appeal, find a question of law and write it. But if you have a moot court where you're not filing an appeal, you're just going for the suit or for criminal matters, for example, bail, you don't have to write question of law, but you need to know it, that what is the basis, okay? This is what I'm saying in all the other cases, understand the question put up for particular section. Now, question that is put up, this question is not the issues written in the proposition. How both of them are different, just understand. Issues are something which you are raising and finding a solution for it. Question is something which the law provides for it. Issues are based on actually facts and they differ from case to case. But question, it does not depend on fact. It depends on the legal part, the law part, the legislation, and it remains the same. That is why once you are able to find the question of law, it would be very easy for you to find the relevant case laws that I'll be discussing in the further part. Okay. This is something that I also mentioned while you were reading the sections. List out the essentials. Point out the essentials of the section. 302 pointers, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the essentials. Now the problem would be based ideally on one or some sections only. Master in those sections and fully understand it. For example, why I'm saying this, if a particular question is there, a particular proposition is on murder, just base your understanding only on murder. 302, punishment, culpable homicide, 300, 301, 302, that's it. Don't go into the full detailed analysis of IPC or full detailed analysis of the chapter. This is very important. You need to understand this. You're only talking about murder, culpable homicide, punishment to murder. That's it, full stop. Don't go here and there. Okay. This is very important that you need to do, although it is not a part of your memorial as such. Then comes application of facts. Once you have highlighted all the essentials of the sections, then start allocating the facts to it. Okay. The most important part is to apply the facts of the proposition to the law analyzed. So if you say this is one, and this is one, I have laid down three essentials. Then find out the facts which is there from the proposition. Find out the facts which highlight this. Find out the fact which highlight this. And then apply these facts to this law. This is how you need to connect the moot proposition. So you understand, if we were not able to decode the moot proposition or understand the moot proposition, we would not be able to do this particular step. And if you are not able to do this particular step, then how will you find the case laws on basis of facts? Because when we talk about case laws, you'll see we have two types of case laws that we need to find. On the question of law, that is the application of law, and second is the application of facts. Okay. So you just apply the facts, pick out and segregate which fact goes to which section, check out the facts with the essentials of the sections. This is something basic that I will not be repeating. Then comes your legal points. What are legal points? Legal points are what I said in the essentials. So sometimes it happens that there are certain legal points that you need to understand. Like the basic thing is difference between culpable homicide and murder. That difference actually lays on the legal points. So you need to understand the legal points. You need to note them down. And these need to be found out during thorough research. They cannot be lying there plainly in the bare act. They cannot be lying there plainly in the books. You need to do a thorough research to find out legal points. Now, why legal points are very important? Because these are the points where you would be grilled in arguments. If you do not find good legal points and the other team are able to find the legal points in that particular sections, you're gone. You would not be able to ask. That is the thing you need to understand. This is how you need to research. Now comes your most important part, that is the cases. The previous research that I mentioned, all these four things, you can take help of Google, you can take help of books, you can take help of internet whatsoever. That's not an issue. But in understanding all these things, all these 4 points, don't go to the research tools till now. Research tools are Manupatra, AIR, or LiveLaw and all these things. Don't go there. Okay? Why I'm telling you this thing, it's a very important thing, because you need to restrict yourself only to the legal points or the laws mentioned in the proposition. If you go and find it in the real scenario, you will be confused, because real thing is very different. Real thing, there's a lot things that are mixed. There would be criminal law, civil law going together against each other. Evidence law would be there. And as I said, in moot courts, evidence law does not play an important part. So that is why don't go there. We'll go to the research tools only when we come to the cases. So once your research is completed as per all these things, find out cases. Cases are to be found out on question of law, on the application of facts, on the sections that are there. So if there is a murder section 302, find out all the laws. Okay. Now, how to research? This is very important. How to research? This is something which I do personally, and you can find your own best way. But what I do is I basically go on the Google and write everything. Okay, so this is very vague. So if I have a proposition where it says that A killed B by stabbing him in the chest, so this is what I would be writing in Google. A person killed the other person by stabbing into the chest. Now, why it is very important? This is the main proposition, because this is something which the whole case is about. You write it and you search it. Search the sections and find out cases and law points. Now, this is very important. When you write it on Google, Google will show you n number of searches. Sometimes it would be articles, sometimes it would be cases, sometimes it would be PPT or podcast, YouTube, n number of things. Go through each one of them. You never know what you will find out. And that is the beauty of researching. You do not actually have a plan until you go and research. Because people ask me, from where do you start? I don't start from anywhere. I find my starting point from Google only. I write this particular proposition and I get n number of articles. I go and read these articles. Whatever I find, now this is very important, whatever you find relevant while reading, just cut, copy, paste. Make a separate Word file with the name of moot court or memorial. Cut, copy, paste everything. I'm not exaggerating. When I do research, the content that I get from all these sites and everything, sometimes it has even reached around 200, 300 pages of Word document, which you have to afterwards sit and segregate what you find relevant. You need to put it. You need to just make a, it is actually a jumble. It's actually a puzzle. You need to just find the relevant portion and attach it. And that is actually time consuming. But once you research and you culminate everything in a Word document, it would hardly take a week to segregate that. So this is one thing. You just write it on basic Google thing. The basic proposition, what you need to write, the main proposition and search it. Now, secondly, there is an advanced Google search. Why I'm saying it's an advanced? The specific law point. Whatever law point that you need to search, write it that. Okay, the specific fact, write that. For example, like I gave you the example, A killed B by stabbing him into the chest. That is the main proposition. Now, I need to find out, like I have researched everything, I have found out the sections and everything. Now I'm stuck in the one particular portion which says that if you're stabbing someone on the chest and the person does not die, then, so I'll write that particular point. Stabbing someone in the chest and the person not dying. What happens then? So then I would find certain papers, research papers, articles, and all these things which were there on reference to the law point which you are taking up. Okay. And why this advanced Google search is very important? This is actually a tip which I'm giving out to you guys. This is what I have actually used in moot courts. When you are reading these cases, the actual real cases, refer to the issues if given in the proposition. If there is a proposition there with you and the issues are mentioned, take that, write that issues and whatever you are getting from the papers, articles, cases, if it forms a part of the issues, if it is relevant to them, write it there, because this will later help you form issues and arguments. Because towards the end, what you have to do, you have to argue. What arguments you need to put, the body, the content of arguments, where do you get it? You actually get it from here. People actually don't take this thing very seriously. They form a memorial, keep it aside, and then they start from the scratch building their arguments. No, that is not how you do. You are not only researching for memorial making, you are also researching for your arguments. If you have a case, in front of you which talks about murder, if it talks about someone stabbing in the stomach, use that things in your arguments, use them in your issues, then only you would be able to argue better, then only you would be getting something real, because you're putting the real arguments in your the real arguments which are there in real cases, you're putting them in your fictional case. So then judge would also be impressed. Oh, and seriously, this guy has done some great research, because he got that particular points which are discussed in the real cases. You understand what I'm saying? And once you're done with it, go for the research tools. This is the extensive research. So there are three types of research: basic, advanced, and extensive. Now, extensive research, any memorial is not complete without extensive research. You need to put up cases. You need to put up cases from Manupatra. You need to put up cases from AIR. And these legal research tools are available for extensive research. They are paid. I know they are paid. But if you are not able to get that, go to Indian Kanun. Indian Kanun is free. Okay. And only use these tools if you have a starting point of your research. This is very important. That's why I said that if you find out through thorough research, if you do not have these legal points and you're directly going on to the research tools, no, you'll get lost, because there are hundreds and n number of cases on one particular topic. You'll be confused as to what to put and what not to put. Okay, so once you are done with these two things, you'll narrow down things. You'll narrow down things as per your issues, as per your arguments. Okay, I got five things, but I like only three. These three have heavy footing, the rest two, they're not as important.
So you research only on those three things. Okay.
So once you have a starting point, then only use these tools. Because as I said, it can lead to finding a needle in a haystack if you don't have a base to start your research on. And research tools, I would not be telling you how to use them. They are very easy to use, just like Google. You need to just put it up. And one thing that I find very wrong with people, they say that once you're using these research tools, you need to know their in and out. Like, they have a particular procedure to search certain things. Don't worry about that. You can implement your own procedure. Okay. Just have a practice of it. Do it once, do it twice, do it thrice. You will not get it. Trust me, fourth time you will get it. So that is something which I think is not very important. If you don't know how to use a research tool, don't worry, you will learn it. You will learn it by using it again and again. So once you are done with research, we are done with second stage also. We'll come to the third stage, that is drafting of memorial. Now this is very important part, and it's a laid down structure also. Nowadays, like in my time, there was only memorial, but when I was exiting from my law school, they started a thing called compendium also. Compendium is nothing but a case mat. The cases that you have referred in the memorial, you will be putting up in compendium also. So it's nothing but just a wastage of money or wastage of paper, to be honest. Now, one of the most important aspects of any moot competition, as it is one of the most important concepts. Why? Because whatever you are writing in are the only grounds of argument that can be taken. So if you have written 5 points of issues in your memorial, you can only argue on those 5 and not on the 6th one. That is why memorial drafting is very important. This line you need to understand and keep it in mind. You need to make an extensive memo. Extensive memo does not mean a long or big memo. Extensive memo means it should include all the things that you want to say. And if in the inclusive part, it is becoming small of 20 pages, no issues, because that's your talent. That you have used so many things and yet you have made a short memo. But if you are going it for 40 pages, still not an issue, because you had a lot to explain. So extensive memo should be there, but it should be relevant and concise. It should not be of 100 pages. Okay, it should be relevant. Don't put irrelevant things in it. Because if you put up a case, only put the excerpt, the important part of the case, and not the full case as such. So this is the format of the memorial. I would also refer to you a sample memo which I only made, and we actually emerged as the winner of the moot court and also the memorial round. So this is the format which you can refer it later. I would just go and refer to the memorial that was there, which we guys won. So I'll just show you the memorial which is there. Okay, see. So this was the memorial. I hope it's visible.
No, it's not presenting.
Okay. Yeah. Now it's visible, right? Yeah. I hope now it's visible, right?
Yes.
So this was the memorial when we went to the Amity National Moot Court in 2019. So you see, the table of content is actually the format. So you can just see this and it would be done. The table of content, it talks, these four things are actually similar. You should not change it. You should change as per your cases. List of abbreviations. Actually, I'll say list of abbreviation is something which is just copy paste. I've also copy pasted it. So this is the first thing which is there, list of abbreviation. Then it is the index of authorities. Case laws, you are free to use n number of case laws which you find, which you like, which you don't like, anything. Statutes are something which you need to refer, books, web resources. This is completely optional. This particular part is completely optional. If you want, you can put it. But index of authorities should have case laws. Case laws are very important. Statement of jurisdiction. This is also very important. It is actually sometimes laid down in the proposition itself. Otherwise, this you need to find out. And trust me, I have seen people doing this thing also wrong. This is, I'm saying, in reality also, people don't know on what particular section you are actually approaching the court. They write this thing also wrong. And this thing is not which you need to argue. But if you're writing it wrong, then judge would grill it. Or if the opposing counsel is smart enough, they would just make your case go away. Because if your jurisdiction is wrong, your case would not be admissible in the court itself. Because this I'm talking in the real life scenario. So this thing becomes very important. Statement of facts, whatever you have written in the proposition, you need to just make it small. And if I talk about this particular memorial, it was based on Sabarimala issue. So I don't need to explain it much to you. And I would be referring to the arguments and the how we drafted it, because that is what is important. But the case is actually of Sabarimala, and totally ditto copy paste was Sabarimala. And sometimes, this is also one thing, sometimes you'll get lucky and you'll find the real case law which the moot proposition is based on. So that if you have a talent, if you can mold it and make it in a sense that people don't know, people don't find out that you have actually used the real case, then that's great for you. But if you're not creative, you're not able to mold it and you use the real case in the moot court, then trust me, you'll fall with your heads down. Because judges know that this particular proposition is based on the real case law, yet they are judging your capability of making it fictional. Okay, so this was something extra that I wanted to highlight. These are the statement of issues. These were provided to us in the moot preposition, and majority of the times are provided in the proposition itself, but sometimes they are not. So you can make up your own issues also. Then is your summary arguments, whatever arguments that you have done. Now, one thing that I need to highlight, you know what summary arguments are. People make this first and then they go on to the advanced arguments, because this is actually the format, but make the advanced arguments first. This is my tip. And once you are done with the arguments advanced, then form a summary of the arguments, because what you are writing here is actually the conclusion. Okay. What you are writing in the summary is actually conclusion, which will form the last part of your arguments, right? So this is one thing that I find really helpful, that don't waste your time in summarizing your arguments first. Make them, and then you can go on and make a summary. Okay, now comes the most important part. How you need to draft your arguments, how you can start, whether to put in law, whether to put in fact and everything. Okay, so you see, if you are able to read it, it says that locus to file. So locus to file is actually the jurisdiction, that whether there is a case that we can come up. So as you know that we are in the statement of jurisdiction, we wrote article 32. So we have included, see, this is how you need to start. You need to start by first giving out a brief line of fact. Okay. And then you need to interlink it with the law. That is the article 32. So this is actually a first paragraph which should be there in all the arguments. Briefly introduce the fact which is relevant for the issue and interlink it with the law. That's it. Okay. Then move on further talking about the legal point. So this is the legal point that we are talking about, because in Sabarimala case, there was a point of norms or usage or custom laid down. Okay. So we talked about that thing and include the case laws whenever it is relevant, along with proper footnoting. Footnoting is very important, and it depends from one competition to the other, which form they are using. Okay. So this is something which you need to understand. There was not much in detail to be written in the first issue. The second issue is actually what I want to discuss. It talks about Article 25 and religious denomination. So I don't know if many of you know about Sabarimala or the articles. I'll not go into the detail, but you see that we have divided our argument into sub issues. Okay. So the first sub, you need to divide it. This is another one thing which is very important. Don't make a long issue as such. If it is around 5 to 6 paragraphs or 7 paragraphs at last, then it is okay to have one issue. Otherwise, divide it into sub issues. Again, the same thing. This is something that is the fact. Then this is the law that we explained. Now it was very important to understand the word denomination. So we included the definition as such. Whenever you are including any definition, write it in italics, whether it's from a source, a statute, or a case law. See, like it is there in the Shirur Math case, we have used it in the italics form. We have directly copy pasted it because it was relevant, and this is what we argued also. Okay. So these are something, just some steps. Like, see, another 5 paragraphs. So we change the sub issue. So this is how it goes. And you can just make it on your own, but just keep in mind the main body. It should be starting from the fact, relevant fact, actually relevant fact, along with the interlinking of law, then your argument supported by a case law. This is how your memorial issues should be. So it is actually a 4-step: relevant fact, interlinking with law, arguments and cases. And lastly, it is prayer. This is the most important part. You need to write it. It's a copy paste thing only. Only these things, the three things actually change as per your relief, what you are asking for. So this is it. This is how your memorial is there. There's no bibliography as such. So you can just, I think you guys would have understood what I was talking about the sample memo. I will send out the sample memo also. So don't worry about it. This we're done with the formatting part. Now we come to the arguments. Now we are approaching to the stage where we'll be presenting the arguments. Before presenting, we need to understand how we need to prepare it. Okay. Now arguments are actually based on the issues. So we need to understand and formulate issues. This step is actually not very relevant, because sometimes issues are given already. So if issues are given already in the preposition, we need to understand them. So in order to form, just ignore the spelling mistakes. It says in order to form issues, one must understand the issues in the proposition first. This is what I said. If they're given in the proposition, don't waste your time. If they're not, you need to form them. Don't go and make numerous issues. This is very important. You need to keep in mind, keep them around 4 only. Maximum there should be 4. Minimum it can be 2, it can be 3. but don't go on making 5 and 6. Okay, issues can be taken up from proposition itself or can be made by you also. So something that I wanted to highlight, which is not very important. This is actually very important part, how you need to prepare your arguments. So a good argument has this particular structure. That this you need to keep in mind what I just said in the arguments advance. So introduction, this is how you need to introduce. Starting with a quote, this is something which I found out many people do to make an argument beautified, but I'm not completely in favor of starting an argument with a quote, because to be honest, I find it cheesy, I find it intimidating, I find it that you are actually trying to hide something in your argument that you're starting with a quote. I'm not ready to listen to a quote in an argument. So that is up to you. If you want to find it that it beautifies it, you can start with a quote or you can start with a legal maxim. Then introduce the issue and argument briefly. You need to introduce it briefly. And okay, one thing I'm telling you about the argument with the issues. I'm not talking about how you need to present it. Presenting is what I'll be discussing later on. Okay, this is just the how you need to form an argument. So you can introduce the issue. You can also introduce the law or the law point. That is up to you. It is your chance to frame the issue. So this is an example that I said that this case is about the inherent inequality of segregated school systems which stamp a badge of inferiority upon minority children. Okay, so you can take these lines if you find them helpful. It is nothing, just introduction. I again repeat, it should be maximum 3 lines. Okay, just 3 lines or 4 lines, it should be just a paragraph. Now comes your roadmap. Roadmap is something which is not a part of your memorial. This is something you need to keep at handy. This is something which is only for your understanding. Roadmap means you need to bifurcate your arguments into issues and sub-issues. You need to interlink it. Okay, so this is something which I made on my own. This is the core of a moot court. So you see, it starts from here, that you formulate issues. On the basis of these issues, you are making arguments. Okay, we are at this particular stage. Now in the arguments, you need to include facts and law. This is what I'm saying, because introduction is this thing. Okay, when you are introducing facts and law, you need to also substantiate them with the cases. See how the interlinking is there. Cases should be based on the proposition, because if you go and find out cases out of the proposition, it would not make sense. So these cases should be based on the proposition. And the proposition, where do we need to find out? The proposition has the issues. So you see how the interlinking goes. And if you understand this interlinking, you will have a roadmap there with you, and you will not be able to forget anything. Now comes your facts. So you see, we are done with the introduction part. Okay. So if we see the roadmap again, we have formulated the issues. We are going in the arguments part. So in the arguments part, we will now talk about facts and law. So this is second thing that we need to see. Our argument consists of facts. So this is something which you need to see, that there's a fact sheet that is given to you, which is a proposition. Now, very important thing is there. Every time you don't have to read out the facts to the judges. It is only going to waste your time, because although you'll say that we are only taking 30 seconds, sir, but those 30 seconds are also important, right? So if you're going like during the starting of the competition, first, second or third, you may ask for the court that may I just reiterate the facts, recite the facts, the judges would say yes. But if you're going towards the end of the competition, keep that in mind, that judges would ask you not to reiterate the facts, because they are also fed up of listening to the facts again and again. So you just need to politely ask, would the court care for a brief recitation of the facts? If the judges say no, skip it, come to your argument. So you only offer to reiterate facts if there is a legal significant error. So if the appellant has misread a fact or misstated a fact, point out that, okay, point that out, and that would be going into your favor, because that would make judge realize that you are aware, you are attentive in the proceedings. Now comes your body of the arguments that I just mentioned in the memorial also. Divide issues and sub-issues. Each sub-issue should have the same structure. Now this is very important. Have a same structure. For example, if you are going for the fact, law, argument, cases, follow this structure only. Follow this particular sequence only. Don't go changing it in every sub-issue. Okay? The argument should only be constrained with what is written in the memorial. So this is, if you have written something in the memorial, you need to only constrain that. That it means that what you're preparing for the oral arguments, you need to just make it constrained what you have written in the memorial and not apart from that. Reiterate the fact which supports your contention. This is very important, which you need to understand. A fact from the moot preposition needs to be reiterated. Cite case laws. Citing of case laws is very important. If you have written 10 case laws in memorial, don't go and cite 10 case laws in the oral argument. Cite only the relevant case law and the relevant portion of it, which actually makes your case strong. And very important point, just note it down. If you are an appellant and you have said a case which is already written in the respondent's memorial, it is for the respondents. Don't cite that case. Okay. Don't cite that case until and unless it is actually making your point. So what I'm saying is, if a case XYZ, which you are going to rely on, has already been relied, has already been proved in his favor by the appellant or the petitioner, don't reiterate that case, because then court will grill you on that. Court will grill you on that in the sense that this particular case, this guy has proved, then how you are taking it up. He would grill you on that particular case and issue. So that is what you are doing actually. Apne pairon pe kuladi marna. So never ever, kabhi bhi wo case mat cite karo jo already cite ho chuka hai by opposite party. The same goes for appellant also. Apne rebuttal mein us case ko mat utha ke lana jo respondent ne pehle hi bol diya hai. Very important thing. And this is the most important part. You need to do it. You need to put it in your practice. Contents of the opposing team's ke memo. Memo mein jo opposing team ke likha hai, usko counter karo aur apne hi arguments mein include karo. Don't keep them for the rebuttal. बहुत लोग ये गलतियां करते हैं, बोलते हैं हम तो अपना आर्ग्यूमेंट देंगे, जो उसने गलत लिखा है वो रिबटल में लेंगे. नहीं, डोंट वेट फॉर रिबटल. रिबटल के लिए यू विल गेट मोर आर्ग्यूमेंट्स. रिबटल के लिए यू विल गेट आर्ग्यूमेंट्स फ्रॉम देयर बोलने वाली चीजें. ओके, व्हाट दे आर आर्ग्यूइंग, व्हाट दे आर गिविंग ओरली, दैट वुड बी योर रिबटल. व्हाट इज रिटन इन द मेमो इज एक्चुअली व्हाट यू नीड टू पुट इट इन योर आर्ग्यूमेंट्स. इट गोज फॉर बोथ द टीम्स. ओके, then these are certain tips which you need to understand. Repeat your opening, add a little bit more detail, which is the facts. This is what substance that I said, that it should include facts, it should include case law. So this is something in repetition. Then transition to second point. It is very important that you need to transit to the second point, or that is the second issue. Okay, then finally it is the conclusion. Last para of each sub issue. It is very important, after each sub issue, I'm not saying issue ke baad to you have to conclude, but after every sub issue also you need to conclude. You need to put a summary of your contention. This is what I'm saying. Okay, this is not a relief, but you think of it as a relief what you'll be saying in the prayer. This is also another very important point that you need to understand. If you see 1 minute is remaining, stop whatever you are doing. Even if you are arguing a case, if you are putting up a case, leave it. Directly skip to the conclusion. Even if it means that your 80% of the portion of argument is left, don't worry, just conclude it. Because judge would only then keep in mind whatever you have spoken along with the conclusion. Okay? If your time has time has finished, then just ask that my time has expired, but may I briefly conclude? And trust me, judges would allow you to conclude. And then conclude briefly. Now, this is a very important thing. This is also very funny that I find. There was this one guy, he said that, sir, my time has expired, but may I briefly conclude? I said, okay, go ahead and conclude. And he went on for 2-3 minutes to conclude. So I had to stop him in between and I had to ask him to just sit down. So this thing is not what you should do. You should briefly conclude it. Even if you have been given extra time, briefly conclude it. Then comes your prayer. Prayer should be included towards the end. Now, a very important thing is people tend to forget to recite their prayer. Every person needs to read out the prayer. If you are not reading out your prayer, and if a person is like me sitting, I would not let you win. Trust me, I would not let you win. Why? Because prayer is something very important. Prayer is actually your everything of your memorial. You're not claiming what relief you are asking. So that is why prayer needs to be recited. The format is specific. I don't need to mention all of it. You need to put all your reliefs into it. Then comes your rebuttal. Rebuttal is something which you are well versed with. It should be 1 to 2 minutes. It should be short. And it is advisable that you only take it up for 1 minute because judges may ask you questions also. Okay, this was something. Now, when we come to the cases, now your argument should come with cases. Now, keep these pointers in mind. I would not be explaining them because they're self-explanatory. It says make your arguments inclusive of relevant and landmark judgments. Take the landmark judgments only if you find them. Cases should be of High Court or Supreme Court preferably. District Court ke cases mat utha ke lana. District Court ke cases koi nahi manta. Until and unless they are very important or your case is in a district court. Okay. But nowadays moot courts are coming specifically for High Courts or Supreme Court. Even if your case is in district court, Supreme Court or High Court ke authority lao, koi bhi mana nahi karega. Okay. So this is very important. District Court ke cases you should not include. And keep this thing in mind. Avoid foreign cases. Do not include foreign cases in your argument. Do not include foreign cases in your memorial until and unless they talk about important law point. Important law point means that a particular law point has been derived from that foreign case and it is very important to put it up. So until and unless that is the scene, don't include it. Try to include the arguments of the cases in your memorial. Now this is a tip also that I gave you. Real cases, these are the cases that I'm talking about, real cases. In real cases, ke jo arguments hain, include that arguments in your memorial or arguments. Okay. Speak only the relevant part of the case. Don't go on and speak everything. Now, this is very important for questioning. Judges would grill you. Sometimes they can grill you on the facts of the case that you are referring. So you should know the facts of the case, brief facts. Okay. Be up to date with the respect of cases. Even if you have not included certain case in your memorial or argument, and you need to understand it. Keep in mind while you are presenting your argument. So these are just basic things that explain your case out loud in simple terms. You should not be over your voice, but you should be clear. You should be concise. You should be giving out your argument with clarity. Focus on making positive points for your side and don't rant. If you're going off topic, slightly come back to the topic. Only focus on positive points. Then one or two pieces of paper, this means that keep a pointer with you. Keep your pointers. I would be talking about 1 point, I would be talking about 2 point. With a paper at your disposal, near your disposal. It should be very simple. If you make it colorful, highlighting and everything, to wahan pe dikhne mein bahut difficult hoga. At the time when you're standing on the podium, it is very difficult to even understand a small thing which is written on the paper. Okay. Now, this is very important. This is a conversation, not a speech. So in a speech, what you do is you go at one length without variation. But this is a conversation. Vary your pitch. Okay. If you are emphasizing something very important, emphasize with your voice. Okay. Like what I'm doing right now. Modulate your voice. You're going at a normal pace, but if you want the judge to listen to a particular fact, go slow. For example, I am highlighting this particular thing and it was mentioned in particular case ABC. So you see, when you're going slow, the judge would actually look up. Okay, there's a voice modulation. So this is something that you need to practice. Voice modulation is very important. Then varying of your pitch is very important. Don't go loud all the time. Don't go slow all the time. Make a balance. Now, this is very important. Anticipate questions on the weak points. If you have any weak point in your argument, ask your team members. ask your researcher what are the weak points and practice on them, because that are the weak points from where you would be getting questions, from where you would be grilled. Okay, these are very important thing, what to bring up with you, big font, bullet points, you need to write that for your pointers. Don't write it in full sentences. These are something just basic thing that you can keep in mind. I will send out the PPT also. Now comes your presentation of the arguments, the procedural part of it. Okay, so we would be discussing about court etiquettes. I would not go into details of it. Court etiquettes are something which you all know about it. I'll not go into the dress code, how you need to stand and everything. I would only talk about the important part, which is first, judges can and will interrupt you at court. Never ever think that judges would not ask you a question. Okay, so if a judge begins to speak or you are at certain she's about to stop, do not talk over a judge. This is very important. Even if he's speaking for 2 minutes, don't worry, let your time go to waste, but do not talk over a judge. Just nod your head, have a little bit smile, make him understand that you're listening to what he's saying. To be honest, although you're not listening, although you're not understanding, leave it, just nod. Whatever he's saying, just nod. Make him think that you are understanding him. Once he stops, then you start again. Okay? Judges can often be belligerent. Not often, they are 110 times belligerent. They are testing your ability to remain poised. You see, they will grill you. Even if you are right, they will grill you. Don't lose your calm. Remain poised. Remain at your point, what you are saying. Even if you are wrong, remain standing there. Remain saying this. Sir, I still think this is the thing. I still think this is the thing. Okay, your honor, your ladyship is something you need, you know how you need to address the judges. You can also say sir, ma'am. That is something lenient which not many of you need to understand. Respect to your opponent, yes, this is something you need to be polite. You should not fight with them. I've seen people fighting in the moot court rooms, okay, fighting and even abusing. So you should just refrain from them. That do not accuse that he's lying, do not attack personally. These are just certain things that you need to keep in mind. How you need to stand at the podium, this is something you need to stand up straight, be steady, and some gesturing is acceptable. Now, this is very important. Sometimes people ask to me that when we are using our hands a lot, is it distracting or not? So, yes, if you're all the time using it, it is distracting. So, keep your hands this way. Keep your hands folded. Keep them on the podium. And once in a while, you can use gestures. Do not point. Now, this is very important. Do not point to the opposite counsel. Do not point to the judge. Pointing is not allowed. Gesturing is allowed. Okay. Gesturing up to an extent. And these are very important thing. You need to speak clearly, slowly. Now, eye contact is very important. And when a particular judge between a sentence. Okay. So, on a particular judge, you need to maintain your eye contact between a sentence or two. And you need to keep on shifting this eye contact. Never ever just make an eye contact with one particular judge. Keep on shifting it to all the judges. And whenever a judge is asking a question, look at him. When he's asking, just look at him in his eyes. But when you are answering a question, look at all the judges. Okay, this is a very important thing. Opening and conclusion should be memorized. Conclusion means your prayer. Opening means your introductory things. They need to be memorized. You should not look down. Never ever read a prayer. You need to learn it by heart. This is a very important thing. That is why I'm saying never look down when you're reading a prayer. Okay, so then this is the manner of presentation. As I said, that how the moot court and trial advocacy is different, so everyone knows about this particular thing, how moot court goes. I think trial advocacy is something different. So trial advocacy has the opening statements, then cross examination and closing statements. This is something which you know, I would not be discussing it further. If you want a separate webinar on trial advocacy, I can do that. So this was something. Bail application, the sample bail application, I can show you if time permits, or otherwise I will send it out. These are very important thing, how to present the arguments. You need to be confident and speak with clarity. This I said before also, if you're diverting, get back to the track. Because this is something very obvious. Sometimes it happens with me also. You divert from the topic. Okay, what you are trying to point out, you go off track from it, but slightly get back on the track. Slightly means without letting the judge know that you went off track. Okay, डोंट ओवर एम्फसाइज ऑन एनी पर्टिकुलर एस्पेक्ट, मतलब एक पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक का पीछा छोड़ दो, ठीक है, बिल्कुल पीछा छोड़ दो, उसके पीछे मत पड़े रहो. अगर वो नहीं समझ आ रहा है जज को, लीव इट. इफ यू हैव पॉइंटेड आउट वन थिंग कि सर ए ने बी का मर्डर किया है, दैट्स इट. इफ ही इज नॉट गेटिंग इट, दैट हिट, दैट्स हिज प्रॉब्लम. डोंट ओवर एम्फसाइज इट, पुट एन एम्फसिस ऑन दैट पर्टिकुलर एस्पेक्ट, गिव वन और टू केस लॉस, दैट्स इट. बट उसके पीछे मत पड़े रहो, बिकॉज यू हैव अ लॉट टू डिस्कस. एंड इफ यू फील अ पर्टिकुलर पार्ट इज नो लॉन्गर रेलिवेंट, दिस नो लॉन्गर रेलिवेंट इज वॉट आई मेंशन्ड, कि अगर कोई ऐसा केस लॉ हैज बीन recited by the appellant which is no longer relevant for you, skip it entirely. Okay, don't just speak for the sake of speaking it, or it is written in the memo. Sometimes I have seen that there's a 20 page memo of respondent, and because of what appellant spoke, there are four issues in 20 pages, and now they have to only argue on two because the two of them have been discredited at all. So yes, they did argue on the two and they even emerged as the winner, so don't worry about it. Creatively present your arguments, be volatile. Now, this is very important. You need to be creative because you don't know what happens there. Okay. You don't know what the appellant would be saying. So, you need to be creative. Be on the spot. The most important point of moot courts is actually the grilling that is done by the judges. So, you need to answer questions. First and the foremost thing, you need to understand the question that the judge is asking. So, listen to the question very clearly. And never say, I'll answer the that later part in my argument, or my co-counsel will answer that. Never do that. Whatever you want to say, say it. Even if your answer is wrong, just say it. Don't worry, but don't skip the question. Okay? Then answer the question directly and then circle back to your outlined argument. Because very important thing is, people tend to forget to get back on the argument. If you're saying a particular thing, judge will ask you a question in between. So he would want to break your flow, but answer that question in 1 minute or 2 minutes. If he's grilling you more, try to get back on the argument. Try to take him in the sense that, sir, I'm answering your question by the way of this particular case, and cite the case and get back on the argument. Because this is what your judge would be seeing. Every time begin your answer with yes or no, whenever it is possible, because he's going to ask you a question. Answer him with yes or no and then give out the reason. Okay, don't be evasive. Know what you can concede and don't be afraid to do so. If you don't know the answer, clearly says, I'm sorry, sir, I don't know the answer. Don't be overconfident. Don't be knowledgeable in every sense, because you are not. So that is why the judges are testing your limits of your argument, because they would, every person has a limit, and if they find your limit, accept it nicely and then come back to the argument. Then time constraints, because you are under time constraints, so you need to keep that in mind. You cannot go on answering the questions of the judges. Okay, try to make transitions back to your argument. Do it. The transitions, they should not look like you have abruptly jumped up. Okay, they need to be in connection with the question. So this is one thing. And the trick that I said, as I understand your question and then restate the question. This buys you time to think of an answer. This is a very important trick that I have myself done. Reiterate the question, because reiterating the question will make the question go over in your mind and you can actually frame the answers. Okay. So this was actually the end of the presentation. Now we are just left with two slides. This is the most important slide that we are doing. That is the do's and don'ts. So do's and don'ts are actually what I would want to be put out everywhere in the law schools. These are the mistakes that people do. Okay. So first I will be discussing about do's. You need to look confident. I'm not saying you need to be confident. Every person in the moot court room, even the judge, is nervous at some point. Even right now I'm delivering this webinar, I'm nervous, but I'm making myself look confident. Even though I'm not confident, but I'm making myself look confident. This is a very important thing. How you can make yourself look confident? By your body language, by your gestures, by your way of talking. So you need to hide your nervousness. You need to hide your fear. Next is, don't deviate from your topic. This is what I mentioned previously also, and I would be emphasizing it again and again. Your topic is something you should not be deviating from. Stand firm with your answer, even if it is wrong. If your judge is grilling you, let him grill. Don't deviate from your answer. Even if you are wrong, accept it. Okay, sir, I accept it. or if you think that you can prove that this particular thing is correct, even though you know it is wrong, do not deviate. Okay. So actually, second and third things are to be read together. Maintain good eye contact. This is very important. Eye contact is very, very essential. Then keep on shifting eye contact. Do not keep eye contact only at one judge, because it would be creepy. If that judge is a lady judge or of an opposite gender, don't just keep your eye contact there. That would be really creepy and that would creep the judge a lot. And one thing that you need to keep in mind, this is look at your pointers. Whenever you're talking, when you're arguing, don't just keep on staring at one of the judges. Look down also. Look at your pointers. Break the eye contact. Because when you break the eye contact, it is very casual and it is very actually elegant that you're making the eye contact again. Okay. So when you're looking at the pointers, you're breaking the eye contact. But whenever you're making the eye contact with the judge again, the judge is also impressed. Okay. He got me back. Right. So this is very important. And one thing you need to keep in mind, when you're making an eye contact with the judge, sometimes judge would not look away. That is the hint for you to look away, for you to look down, or you to look the look towards the other judge, because the judge is giving you hints that it is enough. You're looking at me from very long. You're making eye contact with me very long. So this is very important. People don't think about it, but you need to keep that in mind, and that will come as per your practice. Okay. Practice is this practice is what you can do in front of the mirror, because in the mirror you can see your reflection as the judge. So make an eye contact with your reflection and then keep on looking down. The last point of do's, counter the opposing counsel even before rebuttal. I would say it n number of times. I would say it again and again. Everywhere I go, I say this thing only. Don't wait for the rebuttals. Counter during the arguments only. Then now we come to the don'ts. Never read from the memorial. This is one thing that I hate the most, and all the judges hate the most. They will straight away give you zero if you're reading from the memorial, because whatever you have written in the memorial, we've already read it. Your memorial is also with us. So what you're doing is you're just wasting our time, but you're actually wasting your 15 minutes because you're reading from the memorial. It's not another book that you are doing. Okay. Now, second is argue with the judge. Never argue with the judge, because judge, they are sitting in a position where it will not take this thing from you. Okay. This is just plain blunt. I don't want to explain on this also because it's self-explanatory. Start your argument with countering the opposite team. This is very important. Start your argument how you have thought to start it, how you have written it in the memorial, with the introduction, with the fact, with the law, and then get in between the countering thing. Okay. Don't just start away. I've seen people coming up, your ladyship, the opposite team have said this and this in their memorial, and I want to counter it. This looks really bad because you're starting at the negative note. Okay. Don't start in the negative note in the moot courts. Don't be casual. You need to be professional. We are not your friends when we are sitting on the podium or on the bench. Sometimes people tend to become casual. They say certain things. So that is not okay. Have a flexible or casual body language. You don't have to be flexible at all. Make a poise that you need to maintain throughout your arguments. Maintain eye contact throughout the arguments. Don't maintain eye contact throughout the argument. Keep on shifting. This is what I said, that you need to shift eye contacts. You need to look down. Just counter and present your points or arguments too. Don't just counter. Okay. You need to present your arguments also. If you're only countering, that is making your case only wrong. Now, these are certain tips and strategies that I would say to you. This is the first thing that I mentioned. All the team members must make the memorial and arguments together. You should not divide the work. That researcher will only make the memorial, because that is not good. All the three people need to work as a team. Practice the arguments together and put up questions to each other before stepping into the courtroom as a team, because you are three members. Practice the arguments on each other and let the others put up questions. The researcher, in fact, comes up with great questions because he's the one who is analyzing everything. Even the opposite counsel, he can put up questions which you would... preparing the arguments, look in the loopholes, look between the lines of your argument and find what question can be put up. think as a judge would think. Think if I would be judging a person on this particular argument, what would be the question that I would be putting up? Be thorough with your referred case laws. There's no point of leniency when you are referring case laws. Be thorough with it. Read all the case laws, and learning it or mugging up is up to you. How you would retain it, that is up to you. If you want to write it and retain it, if you have read it and retain it, that is up to you. Read as many cases as you can, as they will help you formulate arguments. I'm saying reading. Don't write as many cases as you can. Read, write concise form of cases, then read as many as you can. And if you ask me, so certain amount of cases that should be there in memorial, it should not be minimum. There should be 30, 35, and it should not be more than 40. So around 30 to 40 is a good amount of case law that can be there. Use arguments from real case laws. This is what I'm telling you as a tip. I have done it. I have emerged as the winner. And even this is one of the greatest thing that you can do. If you're doing it, it's great. Know the essentials of the section by heart. Very important thing. People tend to forget it because this is something what we did during the research part or decoding the proposition. You need to know the essentials. Do not read from the memorial or any notes. Again, emphasizing it, I have written it in bold. Never ever read from anything. Quote cases from compendium or memorial and read out the excerpt. Very important thing is to refer to memorial. If you are not referring to memorial, if you are simply citing your arguments, we will not give you marks. Refer to the your memorials, refer to other parties' memorial. Interact with the judges. Make judges also do something. They're just sitting there, they're just marking. No. Ask them to open your memorial. That is very, very important thing, and judges like to do that. 10th point is something which you need to learn only by practice. You cannot learn it over a webinar. You cannot learn it over 1 or 2 hours of session. Try to find the loopholes in the moot proposition and use for your own advantage. Now, why these loopholes exist, I would tell you. All the moot proposition are based on some or the other real cases, 1 case or 2 or 3 cases, and it is not possible, it is not practical to include everything in the moot proposition itself. So sometimes you don't include everything, so there exists some loopholes. There comes certain things which forms a loophole, and you need to find them and you need to use them for your advantage. Counter the memorial and arguments of the opposing counsel. Again, I've said it. Be vigilant and listen to the opposing counsel's argument, because if you listen to them, then only you will be able to counter. So with this, I'm done with the webinar, the tips and strategies I've laid down. And I said that the international moot courts, everything that I've discussed goes straight in hand with international moot courts also, apart from one thing here and there. And for that, I can take a separate session. So this was something on the fundamentals and the mastering the art of moot court. With this, I'm officially done with the session, and I'm open for any questions, suggestions and everything. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking forward the webinar and spending your time with us, considering the vast and extensive topic. Requesting the participants to kindly put forward the Q&A. We'll also be addressing some of the questions which you have put forward in the Google form as well. But also, if you have any questions after listening to the webinar, kindly do so. Also, the feedback form is also attached in the chat box. So do kindly fill it up with regard to your participation and the certificate eventually. So with regard to the Q&A, if you have any questions, kindly put forward. I think there are a few questions on the Google form, if I could put forward. Since it is already covered, many of the questions have already been covered. A primary question was that, what should be kept in mind first while arguing in the case, and what are the qualities which are seen in an advocate or in someone who's present in the case?
Okay, so the answer to the first part as to what was how to start the argument, right?
Yes.
So argument starting is typically based on the person to person. Some person like to start it with the fact that is given in the proposition. Some like to start it with the law, which is there. That is totally up to them. I would suggest that you interlink them. You don't straight away start from the law. For example, if it's a murder case, you just don't reiterate section 302, section 300, 299, because judges know that. Okay. So you don't go over smart and think that you're telling that to the judges to refresh their memory. No, they have already refreshed their memory. So what you need to do is you need to point out the fact that A was going towards B, then B stabbed A, and that is how this particular law comes into action. So this is how you can start the argument. Coming to the qualities, the quality of the argument, the person who is giving the argument, the first quality is actually his posture, his body language, and the clarity of arguments that he's saying. Because even if you have a quality of arguments with you, and if you're not able to convey to the judge, that goes, that falls down actually. So you need to be very clear. You need to communicate in a concise manner. You need to communicate in a clear manner. You need to communicate in a respectful manner so that people would actually listen to you. And very important thing is, when you are in a courtroom, you're not only delivering it for the judges. Even your participants are listening to you, right? So you need to have a command, you need to have an influence over your own language, over your own thoughts, so that every one of them are hooked to what you're saying. That is the most important quality for an advocate when he's arguing. Apart from that, the quality of argument, if you have a qualitative argument, then that would highlight in your oral arguments also. So this is a something that depends on the quality. Apart from that, the qualities that I have mentioned should be there, that there should be a proper posture, proper respectful manner in the, there should be court etiquettes also. But the major thing that stands in a winner or a loser is actually how he or she is communicating. Okay, so that would be the answer to the question.
Sure. The next question is how to save effective time and but yet complete the maximum amount of arguments without interruption, or even if there's interruption, how do we complete in the so and so time and completing efficiently all the arguments presented?
That is actually a great question, and I would tell you my personal thing. What I do is I make up an argument extensively. Okay, so for example, I will make up an argument of 5 pages with pointers. And this is like my first draft. First draft would be 5 pages argument. I would stand in front of the mirror. I would time myself. It would definitely go more than 20 minutes. And I have only 7 to 8 minutes as one of the speaker. So what I would do is I would cut short those 5 pages to 2.5 pages. Right. So I know how I have cut short it. Then I would again time myself. I would go towards 7 or 8 minutes. Now that is okay. I know I have managed from 15, 20 minutes to 7 and 8 minutes. I have cut down the particular parts. So if needed in the oral arguments, if my time is going beyond what I actually gave, like I bifurcate my time. If first issue is there, I would give 3 minutes to first issue if it's long. Second issue, I would give 3 minutes, and one minute would be for prayer. This is ideally how you should do it, because one speaker would deal with 2 issues. Now, when you are dealing with 3 minute to 1 issue, try to finish that issue when you're practicing in around 2 minutes, because 1 minute you keep it for answering the questions, because judges would grill you. So when you have this kind of formation, or when you have this kind of plan laid down in your brain, you're actually well prepared beforehand. So when you argue in front of the judge, you'll see that your 2 minutes would go like this, and at the same time your issue is actually finished. So you have 1 minute extra. Even if judge does not ask you question, you have 1 minute extra. So what would you do with 1 minute? You take that 1 minute and you put it in the issue two. And what issue two you have culminated, you have shortened it up, slightly go towards the longer part. So this is what my advice would be. Very important thing is practice oral arguments also. Practice oral arguments beforehand, because you need to see your time. You need to see how fast you are going, how slow you are going. Because sometimes I've seen that people have taken up small issues, small content, but they talk so slowly that they are not able to finish them in 7 minutes also. And they end up not reciting their prayer. So that would cut their marks. Because, and as I said, I'll be giving 1 minute for prayer, but actually prayer takes 30 seconds. So I am taking margin. Keep margins in your time limit also, because these 30 seconds, 40 seconds, these are the margins which you will be able to answer your questions. So that is why if you do this kind of time management, time planning, you would not be able to leave out anything.
Sure. There are some who had said that they will ask the questions during the session, but also there's a question as to what are the preparation tips for international MOOCs?
Okay, preparation tips for international MOOCs are, like, first would be never ever go to the international MOOCs if you have never done any national MOOCs at all. Okay, so this would be my first tip. And if you are preparing for an international MOOC, the very good thing or very important thing about international MOOCs are that they give out materials. They give out their reading materials. So you don't have to go here and there and research for them. First, read out those materials. First research them. So they're actually a good amount of material. They give around 10 to 8 materials, a good thick copy of 100 to 200 pages. And everything is written in them. So you first go through the proposition, like I have said, that is the same strategy that you need to take. If you are able to decode the international MOOC proposition, trust me, if you are able to do that, give me a call, give me a message, and I would definitely give you a surprise gift, because that is a tough thing to do. A 10, 15, 30 page international MOOC code problem is not at all easy to decode. And if you are able to decode it, along with the applicable laws, along with relevant facts in issue, you're going great. You will do great in that particular MOOC code or in any other MOOC code. Once you are done with the decoding of international MOOC problem, directly skip to the research materials, the case mat or everything that you have given, that is given to you. Master yourself in them. Even if it takes 2 weeks, just master yourself. Because the major problem is, when we talk about national MOOCs, we are well versed with the laws, because this is what we have been dealing with in our day-to-day life. But international cases or international MOOCs, the case laws are such that we don't know anything about them. We don't know because we have not dealt with them in the daily basis. And that is where India lacks. Because in foreign countries, they know, they study about procedure of UN, they study about procedure of ICJ, but we have not heard about it. We don't know the rules, we don't know the procedures. So we need to get well versed with them first. That is when we will be at par with them. And so the second preparation for international MOOCs would be to understand the reading material that is there. And once you have understood the reading material, you can go and do the research that I have done from the basic Google search, then advanced Google search, and then research tools. Research tools are actually different for international MOOC. And very shockingly, I found out some free to use websites also that provide free research case analysis. And I would be happy to share the link, because that is what I used when I prepared for the JSEP also. So yeah, that would be the strategy. Apart from that, everything is same. You need to be confident. You need to have an open or creative mind to actually prepare for any. So this would be the strategy.
Sure. I think we have a question in the chat box by Naisha Nathan. She mentioned that I'm a first year student who has begun mooting and I'm unfamiliar with what exactly a compendium is. Could you please explain me the same in brief?
Okay, so hi Nisha. Nisha, see, the compendium is not actually compulsory. It depends from different colleges to colleges and different competitions to competition. Like in my college, during the last years, they introduced compendium. So compendium is nothing but a case mat. So all the cases that you have mentioned in the memorial, you will be putting the cases in there. So the difference is actually why it was introduced. I'll tell you the practical application of it. You see, even if you go into a courtroom, this is I'm talking about the real courtroom. If you go into the courtroom and you highlight or reiterate a case, you only see the name of the case and the relevant portion of it. Even then the judge asks that, can you please give me the copy of the judgment? So we hand over the copy of the judgment to the judge. So that copy of the judgment is actually what is a compendium. Okay, so it's some copies of judgment. All the judgments that you have referred would be there in a form of a document. So when I talk about the compendium in MOOC courts, in memorial, as I said, you're mentioning the case. You're just writing the name of the case along with the citation and you are giving the excerpt and you are explaining it. Okay. The judges sometimes are not aware, like many of the times they are aware of it, but sometimes they're not aware of the facts that go into the case or where the case lies, because it's not practical to get mugged up with all the cases. And if we say each and every student, each and every team gets 30 cases, so if there are around 10 teams also, it would go around to 300 cases. So it's very impossible to learn that. So that is why the colleges, for the ease of judges, they have started the concept of compendium. So what you do is, whatever cases that you have mentioned in memorial, whether it's in the footnote, whether it's in the memorial, or whether you are using it in the argument, you take the copy of the relevant page, relevant portion of it, like the like if there's a para 13, it is on page number 32. So you will take the printout of page number 32, highlight para 13, that would be one. And along with it, the main page of the judgment, which talks about the court, the parties, and usually the first page. So the first page and the relevant page of the judgment will form the compendium of all the cases. So compendium is actually of the cases, and you can relate it to as a case material.
Definitely. Yeah, so I think we have one more question. I have it's from a fourth year law student who has posed it in the Google form. I have a research publication and have published several online articles. Will it still be considered as a drawback if I haven't mooted quite enough in spite of being a fourth year?
Okay, that's actually a very subjective question. Because to be honest, it doesn't really matter. Like, moot courts give you a kind of a practical knowledge, a practical approach to how court works. But what I would say is, moot courts don't actually should be considered in this sense, what I just said. They should be considered more for enhancing your personality. For enhancing your, I would say, personality is the word which, like, I came up with a word called advocality. Okay. So advocality is the personality of an advocate. So a particular advocate should have a personality, how to argue, how to present himself in the court. So moot courts are actually making your advocality. They are making your personality. So it should be seen from that sense. So if you have not participated in the moot courts, that's not at all an issue, because at the same time, it is up to your hand. If you have enhanced your personality yourself, then also it is great. And even if you have done a moot court, or even if you have not done a moot court, when you step out of the law school, when you enter into a courtroom, you are a fresher. You don't have the knowledge at all. You cannot use moot court's knowledge into the courtroom. If you use that, you will be sent out. Sometimes it is also contempt. So you cannot do that. That I'm telling you bluntly. So even if you have not participated in any moot court, whether you are fourth year student, fifth year student, that hardly makes them actually a matter. But I would say that all those who are first year, second year students, you can try it out. Even third year students, you can try it out. It's one of an experience, but it is not compulsory. If you are not into doing it, no issues. At the same time, he mentioned that he has done and many research publications. So research publications would definitely help you, because you're researching, you're writing it. It would help you in your CV. It would help you to get a good job. So these are the things that make the difference. And in India, if I talk about the recent scenario, it's hard to get a corporate job. It's hard to get a job in a firm. So if you're doing anything which glorifies your CV with respect to the landing of job in towards the firm, that is great. And litigation jobs are actually easy to get, because they are hardly paying. This is something I'm telling you honestly, because they're hardly paying any person. So even if you have done a moot court or not, and you want to go into litigation, you need to keep it in mind that you will not be paid good, and you are stepping it there only for the learning base, or you are stepping to enhance your personality. So this is what I would like to say. As such, there's no issue if you have not done any moot court, or if you have done many articles. It goes vice versa also.
Definitely. I think if there are any other questions, kindly put forward in the same. In the meanwhile, also fill up the feedback form once again, as put forward in the chat box with regard to participation in the webinar. If you have any other further questions regarding the webinar or also regarding several key aspects about mooting and how you could go ahead, you could put forward in the session. Or also if Sagar put forward any point of contact details, be it email or be it through other social media platforms, accordingly, we can put forward the details as well in the session.
Yeah, sure, Joel. You can share my account details also if you want. Otherwise, I can. You can share my number.
I must share it in the chat box.
Yeah, you can share it in the chat box. You can share my number. You can share the email ID. And if you guys have any doubt or anything, you can contact if you need any help also. Because I also had mentors and I would thank them what I've achieved till now, but being a first generation lawyer, I know how hard, how tough it is to go into the field without a mentor, without mentorship. So that is why I'm saying if you need any help, you can contact me. And moot court is just something which should be actually a part of the curriculum like NLUs have. Not many colleges are making it a part of curriculum. They should make it. And I appreciate the participation in the moot courts. And to be honest, the online moot courts do not have that vibe like it used to have in the physical sense, like in the offline moot courts. So once the colleges reopens, I would suggest each and every one of you should participate in offline moots. You should travel to different cities to look for national moot courts. And once in a while, have this dream that you will participate in JESSUP. JESSUP is one of the biggest moot courts of all over the world. It's actually the moot court championship or world cup of moots, like many names have been said. So you participate in JESSUP, because JESSUP, even if you don't win, you will get to learn a lot, how to handle certain things, how to handle international matters, what goes into it, the working and everything. And you will be associated with JESSUP. Like I participated in JESSUP, we did not win, but now I'm associated with the JESSUP organization. They've asked me to judge the national round. They've asked me to judge the memorial round. So even if you have participated for once, you can get a good amount of exposure. You will get good amount of friends. They can help you out. This is something that I would just like to highlight. And I hope every one of you understood what the basic structure of mooting is, because I don't think when I was also in the moot court society or in my law school, anyone would have explained these things to me, the do's and don'ts, how to research and everything. This is what I have learned from the 5 years of law school and my own practice. You should include them. So this is very important that you need to understand.
Definitely. Yeah. Just a second. I should be putting forward the email as well. You can make contacts through the email as that's the correct email, right?
Yeah.
So you make contact through the same. And we are also, if any of you want to know regarding future events about webinars also led by Sir and also other events by Argumenta Podcast, we are also creating a group. So accordingly, you may join in the WhatsApp group or even you can get updated about the same through mails. Now I'll be handing over to Minaj, who'll be doing the vote of thanks.
Good evening, sir. I'm Minaj. I'm also a co-founder of Argumenta Podcast. And at first, at the outset, I must tell you that despite being in my third year, I don't think I've got this kind of information from anybody. This kind of detail, it was more of a toolkit on how to excel in moot courts, be it college, intra-college, or even inter-college, national and international moot courts, sir. And for that, we thank you. We thank you for using this platform to share your knowledge and give us the tips that would allow us to inculcate these tips and become better mooters in the future, sir. And we extend our hearty gratitude towards you on behalf of Argumenta Podcast as well. And we look forward to having you on further sessions, sir. If there's any closing remark you would like to make to all the listeners, sir.
First of all, I would like to extend my thanks to the whole team for having me here. It was a great experience to share my knowledge. I always wanted to have a platform where I could share whatever knowledge I have, whatever I have learned. And this was great, and I'm happy to get in association with you guys. I'm happy to get in connection. I would love to give my knowledge about other topics also, whether whenever and whether required. And in the closing remark, I would just like to say that go out, experience new things, not just restrict yourself to moot courts. It is just one aspect of law schools. There are n number of aspects to it. Write research papers. Don't just write it and publish it. Present it. Presenting is very important also, I would just like to say. Nowadays, online presenting is happening, because presenting is also what you are doing in mooting also. That is similar. So you can do n number of things. Just keep yourself occupied. Do something or the other thing. If you get a chance to do a moot court, trial advocacy, bail application, there are mediation competition, negotiation competition, get into it. Because you will know the procedure. You'll see it, you'll be inclusive of that. And that would help you in longer run. So this is what I just want to say in the closing remarks. Once again, thank you for having me here.
It was indeed a pleasure, sir. And we look forward to having more sessions with you. And to all the listeners here and all the participants of the meeting, we request you to join the WhatsApp group and also fill out the feedback form in order to get your certificates. Thank you.
Yeah. And also, this session will be available as a record session through our platforms, be it on YouTube, Instagram, Spotify. So you can check it. You can actually find them out on Instagram and YouTube. So it's @argumenta_podcast on Instagram, and also Argumenta Podcast on YouTube and Spotify. And also regarding for future events, like Minaj mentioned, and also like Sir, since Sir is also an immediate member of our of the podcast, so if the regard to future events and webinars, Sir would be holding forward, you can join our WhatsApp group. And also we'll be sending forward regular updates. Also those, once again, as a reminder, if any of you all haven't really filled the feedback forms yet, so kindly do so in regard to the certification. And then once again, I'd like to thank Sir once again for coming forward. And thank you all for joining us and spending your time as well. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
This current episode, the full length, will be available on YouTube, and also you'll be able to find our latest updates about the session as well on Instagram and other platforms as well. So do like, share and subscribe to our channel on YouTube, and also follow our Instagram page with regard to regular updates as well.